Good morning. There will be treacherous conditions on the roads in parts of Britain as several centimetres of snow are expected to settle.
Disruption too on the railways, although it's not the weather, but continuing delays to engineering works that's behind the trouble on the tracks.
And in chilly conditions last night, Newcastle and Liverpool slipped up, so it's still shaky for Big Sam. That's what we're talking about on the News Hour today. It's Thursday, the 3rd of January, 2008.
Good morning from me. You're watching the News Hour. It's just gone 6 o'clock. Also on the programme today, Sue Jamieson has travelled to Kenya for us to report on the latest violence as Nairobi prepares for a mass demonstration.
And how much do you know about the candidates bidding to become the next president of the United States? We're live to Iowa in America as the presidential race proper gets underway. We'll tell you how that vote could have implications for our future.
Yes, and we'll meet three sisters who made the tough decision to have double mastectomies to rule out a family risk of breast cancer.
But first, let's get today's weather. Good morning, Claire.
Good morning. Well, today's going to be bitterly cold wherever you are. Now, if you live in the west, particularly Northern Ireland and Western Scotland, perhaps even Northwest England, you'll be seeing some lovely sunshine. It's not going to help the temperatures at all, though. And then to the east and to the south, that's where the conditions are pretty awful. Even this morning, we're seeing snow showers move in across central and eastern areas of Scotland and Northeast England, anywhere down towards the Humber Wash area. Currently, we're seeing an area of cloud and rain slowly move its way northwards as it hits the cold air through the morning into the afternoon. We are likely to see some snow here. Elsewhere then, as you can see, temperatures really struggling, 3 or 4 at the very highest, but struggling to get above freezing across much of central and southern parts of the country. Gloria.
Claire. The top story this morning, drivers are being advised to prepare for hazardous conditions this morning with snow and freezing temperatures forecast for much of the country. The Highways Agency is preparing a fleet of gritters to treat motorways and A roads. Rachel Harrison is in Durham City Centre for us. Rachel, what's it like where you are?
Yes, good morning, Gloria. Well, I've actually driven from Manchester and I've seen the first snow of 2008 in parts of Leeds and coming through Darlington. And we've seen a light dusting here in Durham, but as the day goes on, we're expecting it to get far worse. Large parts of the country are going to be affected and the gritters have been out in force overnight in southwest of England, the southeast of England, up to Lincolnshire and anywhere north of the Wash, right up to Scotland. Now, we're being told we're going to have around 10 centimetres of snow in the higher areas of the country and around 2 to 4 in some of the low-lying areas. But the highways agency is warning people that if you're going out today to take extra flasks, blankets, clothing, just in case you got caught if you're going to the more remote parts of the country. But as I say, it's not going to be too bad as you're going into the commute into work, but it will get worse during the day. And if you're a child that's off school at the moment, the good news is you're going to have some snow. The bad news is the snow spell is only going to be for around 24 hours, so enjoy it while you can.
Stay warm, Rachel. Thanks very much.
Let's catch up on the rest of the news. Here's Priya.
Thanks, John. Good morning. In Kenya, the opposition leader has insisted that a banned march will go ahead today, despite concerns it could lead to further violence. 1 million protesters are expected to rally in the capital, Nairobi. Hundreds of people have died in the troubles following the re-election of President Kibaki last week. The Foreign Office has warned against all non-essential travel to the country. The rail regulator says it's launching an urgent investigation into the engineering delays on the West Coast mainline, which threatened to disrupt commuter travel again this morning. Network Rail has admitted a shortage of staff is to blame for the problems and may now be fined. Well, Jackie Kabler is at Birmingham International Station for us this morning. Jackie.
Good morning. Yes, Virgin Trains have advised their passengers not to travel again today. They've described the whole thing as a fiasco, very badly affected by it. Of course, what it's due to, just as a reminder, is these engineering works which have overrun now for the fourth successive day on the West Coast Main Line, basically closing an area of track between Coventry, Northampton and Milton Keynes. And that has caused huge knock-on effects. Passengers yesterday describing nightmare journeys extended by 2 to 3 hours in some cases, many people being transferred to buses and no trains at all. fall in many parts of the country, and it really is going to be a similar picture today. Network Rail say it's down to a shortage of specialist staff. They have apologised, but they don't seem able to tell us when the trains will be back to normal. The rail regulator has launched an investigation, and Network Rail could face a hefty fine over this, as well as the closure yesterday of Liverpool Street Station in London, again due to overrunning engineering works. Meanwhile, this issue is going to be raised in Parliament as a matter of urgency next Monday when they return from their Christmas break. Labour MP Louise Ellman demanding an explanation and an apology to the thousands and thousands of people affected by this. Network Rail are refusing to comment on reports that it could be next Monday, Priya, before things get back to normal.
Jackie, thank you. The missing data scandal may be much worse than the government's admitted, according to a group of MPs. A report by the Commons Justice Committee warns that the massive security breach at Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs wasn't an isolated case, and it's calling for government departments to be held criminally responsible for data protection breaches. The record price of oil, now trading at $100 a barrel, means that UK motorists are to face the highest ever prices at the pump. Filling a typical 50-litre tank now costs £7.36 more than a year ago. That's according to the AA. The race for the White House begins today in the American state of Iowa. Voters there will decide which candidates from the Republican and Democratic parties they want to run for US president. Well, Sarah Moore is in the state capital of Iowa, Des Moines, for us this morning. Morning, Sarah.
Morning, Priya. It's certainly an important job. The President of the United States of America, George W. Bush, will step down in November, and the race for his replacement is on. All eyes are on Iowa. Today we'll get the first indication of who that could be. Voters in the state will go to a caucus where they'll have their say on who they want running for president. Now, the Democrat frontrunner is former First Lady Hillary Clinton. She's favourite in the polls. She says her time in the White House with her husband Bill gives her the experience for the job. But she's neck and neck in some polls with a younger, fresher candidate, Barack Obama. Now, Barack Obama made his decision to run last February. He says that he's young, he's got a fresh approach to this. He's certainly been campaigning tirelessly over that time. But the main problem the candidates have is actually getting the voters out to vote. They're going to extraordinary measures to do that, shoveling snow from people's driveways and providing babysitting services so parents can go and vote. Now, the candidates, main candidates for the Republican Party expected to win is either Mike Huckabee or Mitt Romney. They're favourites in Iowa, but the favourite nationally is former New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani, but he's not concentrating on Iowa, he's concentrating in polls in other states.
Lots going on. Thank you, Sarah. Look what's on our website this morning. Discover the top 10 overseas property hotspots for 2008. Are you happy with your body shape? Take part in our New Year lifestyle survey. And we reveal what you're most likely to leave in a hotel room. All that and more on the website, gm.tv. It's now just coming up to 6:08. Back to Gloria and John.
Thanks very much, Dee. Priya, let's take a look at the morning papers. The Mirror highlights the tragic case of a guy who went out to look for his dog and was murdered by youngsters allegedly high on vodka. The Daily Mail, pay mum to look after the children. Parents should get tax breaks to help them bring up their children, according to Gordon Brown's researchers. Daily Express says that millions of householders could be hammered with an extra £140 a year on their council tax bills. The Sun highlights the case of Joey Barton, the Newcastle United footballer, who's currently in custody, saying that he's crying himself to sleep while he's on remand. And on the front page of the Daily Star, Save Our Rovers. That's a follow-up to their piece yesterday, saying the Rovers' return is going to close.
Look at the broadsheets now. The Independent has an in-depth look at all the candidates who want to be the next president of the United States. The Daily Telegraph looks at GPs urging millions hit by that vomiting bug to stay at home. We've certainly had bouts of it in our office. I'm sure you may have too. The Times talks about the impact that the high price of oil may have on the rest of our economy. And The Guardian, the only newspaper to splash their front page with what's happening in Kenya, murder of the children who sought sanctuary in church. And we stay with that subject now as a mass demonstration is expected to go ahead in Nairobi today despite a government ban on it. Meanwhile, foreign nationals are continuing to leave Kenya following violence in the country. Hundreds have already died. On the line now is Phil Thomas from the charity Girl, which is based in Nairobi. good morning to you.
Good morning.
Could you explain what your personal situation, what's your daily life like?
Okay, well, there's been relative calm in the more affluent residential areas the last few days, so we've managed to get ample supplies in. So basically myself and all my colleagues are just ready to stay at home with locked doors for the next few days to see what happens.
Would you like to leave the country?
Well, our plan is to... We've got a contingency plan to try... We're in the process of trying to secure flights out on the weekend after these, you know, after seeing what happens over the next few days. If we are able to travel to the airport and we feel we still need to, then we will.
And what's your hunch? If this demonstration does take place, can you see the flames being fueled even further?
It's very worrying at the moment. We don't know what's going to happen in the next few days. With, you know, with this demonstration today, where the government has banned it and the opposition leaders are still mobilising everybody, so nobody's sure at all of what the outcome's going to be. And the ethnic tension, the attacks from one ethnic group affiliated from one side and the attack on the other side, is still increasing. So it's quite a worrying situation.
Well, we hope you stay safe and we thank you for talking to us this morning.
Time now 11 minutes past six, time for some sport, and Sam Allardyce, the Newcastle United manager, has admitted that he's under mounting pressure following their defeat last night to Manchester City, reflecting the headlines this morning. Is that the sack you're looking at, Sam? The headline in the Mirror and in the Daily Mail, Sam's agony, joined now by Paul Elliott, former Chelsea and Charlton star, to discuss that match and others. I mean, will they sack Sam, do you think, or will they wait until the outcome of the game against Stoke City, their FA Cup game on Saturday?
I think that seems more probable. I mean, ultimately, John is in the results business. However, their form has not been good. Three defeats back-to-back, only a possible 1 point in the last 12. Not playing particularly well. Great, massive expectation by the Geordie faithful. But they must give him time. Patience is key. And all the great managers, John, they've gone through their turbulence. And the board, the chairman, the owners, they've stuck by him. And I hope that's applicable in this case.
Well, they all needed a lot of patience last night when they faced Manchester City. I'm allowed to smoke a little bit, I suppose. who won 2-0. These were the goals we're going to look at. Now, the first came from Milano. What a genius.
Oh, a pure talent. I mean, it's a good little link-up play. He actually started it, John, and it's a clinical finish on his left side for his sixth goal of the season. Excellent link-up play with Fosu, and he comes on his left side, and it's a stunning execution from a player of the highest order. And the second goal from the substitute, Fernandes. Good little link-up. His first touch to Swiss player in his 75th minute, and obviously makes it game, set and match. And I must say, the Newcastle defensive line was woeful.
Yeah, it was woeful, and the Newcastle fans voted with their feet 10, 15 minutes before the end even. They were streaming out of the ground. It's not good news for them, and it's a shame because it's a great club and a great bunch of supporters there.
Concur with you, John.
Good news for Manchester City, though. They're going to go to fourth place, funny as you mentioned, because Liverpool slipped up badly against Wigan, didn't they, last night?
Yeah, but, you know, you've got to give Steve Bruce a lot of credit. You know, done an excellent job, John. The impact he's made has been very impressive, but Liverpool, they are struggling the point situation at the moment. I mean, it is a game, John, it was a must-win. And obviously it was Torres scoring his 16th goal out of a possible 24 this season. Been in outstanding form, but it's the supply around him. There's an over-reliance and a great dependency on him. But obviously later in the game, it was an equaliser. They failed to clear the ball. What a stunning, exquisite strike by Bramble, central defender as well, John.
Second time in two games.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, he's settled. He's making a very, very good impact. And certainly Steve Bruce, though, has done extremely well.
Can he save them?
I think, yes, they've moved out the bottom three. Sunderland's gone down with their defeat, and the odds look good for them at the moment.
Let's have a look at the sequence of events over the festive season. We've compiled our own little top four of teams who've done particularly well over the festive season. Well, there they are.
Well, it's all about consistency, John. If you look at Arsenal, okay, they drew at Portsmouth, but beat Everton comprehensively 4-1 and 2-0. And obviously Chelsea with the same, you know, 4-4 in the epic with Villa, 2-1 with Newcastle and Fulham. And ultimately, Manchester United is all about consistency. They got beat by West Ham, but 4-1 against Sunderland and Birmingham, and Liverpool struggling 10 points off Man United and 12 points off the top, John.
Just briefly, do you think those top three will be the top three at the end of the season?
A resounding yes.
Yeah, with Manchester City fourth, of course.
John, wish you well.
Thank you very much, Deepaw.
You're watching the NewsHour on GMTV. Good morning. This morning's headlines. Drivers are being advised to prepare for hazardous conditions this morning, with snow and freezing temperatures forecast for much of the country.
In Kenya, the opposition leader has insisted a banned rally by a million protesters will go ahead today, despite concerns it could lead to further violence.
And the rail regulator says it's lodging an urgent investigation into the engineering delays on the West Coast Main Line, which threatened to disrupt commuter travel again this morning. So, a barrel of oil hit a record price of $100 yesterday, the front page of The Times. But how is it going to impact on us? Will petrol prices rise even more? Well, I'm joined by Justin Urquhart-Stewart from the London Stock Exchange. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
First of all, why is this happening? Why has it gone up?
Well, actually, what happened yesterday, there were some specific trades that pushed put it over. The whole market wasn't moving above it, but there was particular trades that put over $100. But you could see what was happening. We had a cold weather in America, short-term snap on that. We've had concerns about production in Nigeria. But there's often an awful lot of speculation going on as well, people trading these things on the basis that there's liable to be a supply shortage. No shortage of oil, it's just a shortage of refining capacity. And that's what's causing a problem coming through. So add a bit of speculative nerves over it, over Christmas and things like that, it pops over $100 a barrel. And you can see the reaction already feeding through in terms of some of the prices. Our petrol prices don't reflect the $100 yet. Well, they will do in due course. But bear in mind one thing, these are dollars. The dollar's been falling right the way down. Meanwhile, the price of crude's been going up. What's been happening is a lot of the oil producers want to get their money's worth back in dollars, but because the dollar's cheaper, they need to charge more for it. So that's why you're seeing this squeeze. But it will affect us. We're going to pay more. I was sitting at a petrol station yesterday up in North Wales, and I've never seen the price of petrol there being quite so much. It was eye-watering filling up my car. It was, yeah, I think it was actually slightly over that.
Really?
Yeah.
What about gas bills? Would it impact on those too?
What's going to do it? It'll impact right the way through all the costs of the system. So in terms of manufacturing, in terms of power production, so electricity costs and all those sort of things, it comes its way through. In terms of petrol prices, though, bear in mind over 80% of our petrol price is tax. It's not actually oil price at all. So actually, we're slightly protected. We're also slightly protected because we've got a stronger dollar, a stronger pound against the dollar. Watch out, because we're going to have interest rates, maybe as early as next week, coming through into the United Kingdom, which may be good news for us who are borrowing, but that also means the sterling's going to be weakening, probably against the dollar, and therefore that price of crude will start to affect us more. So I'm afraid prices are going to stay higher and probably stay higher.
And briefly, that could have an impact on interest rates.
Well, interest rates will be coming down. That's pretty likely. However, there are inflationary pressures too. Sure. And this is the big argument. Do you cut interest rates to save the economy, or do you actually keep them where they are to fight off inflation? To be discussed.
And we'll discuss it with you, I'm sure, at a later point. Thank you very much.
OK, lots more still to come this morning, including Claire. I'll be telling you where the wintry weather is hitting this morning.
And we'll check out the contenders to become the most powerful man or woman in the world.
Her blood pressure's unrecordable.
Don't tell me what to do!
It's our future that matters to me.
I can't feel a pulse.
Police are on the way.
I think we've done all we can.
It's time for your daily dose. Brand new Today Time. The Royal Today, Monday at 4, ITV1.
Imea, menopause and silhouette. After all, it's only natural for a woman to want to look good. Imea, menopause and silhouette. For the time of your life.
If you're going to do one sale, do the big B&Q sale. There's 20% off all kitchens, flooring and tiles. Just spend over £300. That's on top of sale prices.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
But hurry, offer ends January 7th.
Everybody's talking at me.
Look for the digital tick when converting your old TV or buying new TV equipment. It means it's ready for the digital switchover.
When you had diarrhea this morning, you had a choice. Did you hope it might go away by itself? Or did you take Imodium Plus? Why risk upsetting the rest of your day? Take Imodium. Take control.
Up there is the Golden Bank, full of golden balls. Each of them could be worth anything up to £75,000.
I love you.
With all that cash, which of our players has the golden balls to bluff their way through to the big money?
I'm greedy. I'm sorry.
But who's lying and who's telling the truth?
If you do have another killer, admit it.
Now, one of you two is lying about it.
I can't help it. That's the balls that was dealt with me.
Join Jasper for a new series of Golden Balls, weekdays at 5, ITV1.
Welcome back to the time, 20 past six. Very good morning to you if you're just joining us. The race for the White House begins in earnest today as the first US presidential votes take place in the state of Iowa. So who are the candidates fighting it out for the top spot and what will it mean for us here in Britain? Here's Sarah Moore.
In 2008, this man is out and the White House will be home to one of these, all fighting it out to be the next president of the United States.
The next president won't be decided until November, but the race officially begins today in Iowa. Television stations from across the world are here, waiting to see who they pick in this state to be the candidate for the Democrats or the Republican Party to fight for the White House.
So what happens? Well, anyone registered to a party can go to the caucus. They turn up and raise their hands or stand in a group for the candidate they want to support. A vote is taken, and the one with the most votes is the preferred presidential nominee for that party in that state. It's an open race, and all eyes are on Iowa for an early indication of who could be running America. It's the first in the nation to go to the polls. Already, it's a showbiz affair, looking more like political idol. The main Democrat contenders, Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton, have both added glitz and glamour to their campaign. The former First Lady counts her husband Bill and Madonna as her number one fans. But then Oprah Winfrey has been running campaigns for Obama, and with Brad Pitt and Will Smith also backing him, he wins a celeb vote. But will that be enough?
But there's competition on the Republican side. The main contenders for the nomination in Iowa are Mitt Romney and Mike Huckabee, with Rudy Giuliani leading the polls nationally.
Well, joined in the studio now by American Studies expert Professor Phil Davis. Good to see you. Thanks very much indeed for getting up to talk to us. What will this mean for us here in the UK, assuming, say, for example, the Democrats win the election at the end of the day in November?
Well, the main difference is between the two parties rather than between the individuals fighting for the party nominations. And probably the main issues that would affect Britain would be things like Iraq, Iran and climate change, because the rest of the domestic stuff doesn't really affect us at all. But on Iran, for instance, the Republicans talk a rather more belligerent line. On Iraq, the Democrats are more eager to get out. And on climate change, you've still got some of the Republicans who hardly believe it's happening at all.
That would be a tricky one for Hillary Clinton if she were to become the President of the United States, given that she voted for the war in Iraq in the first place.
Well, this is true. It's also true of Edwards. But both of them have now turned their positions. But they're still slightly different. Hillary's looking at a slow withdrawal and the idea of maintaining some American presence, possibly as long as 2013, whereas Edwards is talking about getting the troops out in 10 months.
We do have the prospect, if Hillary Clinton does win, of her being the first female to be President of the United States, mm-hmm. and we have the prospect of Obama wins, of him being the first African-American mm-hmm. To be President mm-hmm. of the United States. And one wonders, if that was the case, if the Republicans were pushed out of the picture, largely because of Bush's unpopularity, what's the relationship either those two would have with Gordon Brown here in the UK?
Gordon Brown's links into the Democratic Party are strong. He is quite an Americophile. He visits a lot, and he has good links into the Democratic leadership. So I think that whoever, if the Democrats won, I think that whoever it would was, Gordon Brown's team would have quite good connections with them.
Ex-mayor of New York, Giuliani, who many people will remember, of course, for his heroics after the September the 11th atrocity, is shying away a little bit from Iowa. He's concentrating on events nationally. Do you think he's in with a chance, given the unpopularity of George Bush at the moment?
Oh, he's in with a chance. His problem is that for many Republicans, he's seen as a little too liberal on social affairs, on things like abortion and such, which is one of the reasons why he is fighting shy of Iowa, which is a religious, on the Republican side, a religious conservative
state. Well, they were the people who won it for Bush last time, weren't they?
Well, they were indeed, and this is why someone like Mike Huckabee, who is not doing well nationally, is looking so good in Iowa. Mm. On the whole, one thinks that Mike Huckabee will probably fade after this. Giuliani will get his chance in the later states.
So Tough call, I know, but if you had to put your last fiver on who's going to be the next president of the United States, who would it be?
It is a tough call. It's so close on both sides. I think that probably Hillary is still marginally the favourite.
For now.
For now.
Wise man. Phil, thanks very much for being with us.
Thank you.
It's exciting, isn't it? Time for the weather now with Claire.
Hello there. Well, for some of you, you'll be seeing at least 36 hours of snow. Accumulations could be up to, in the most remote places, 8 inches, particularly across central and eastern areas of Scotland. And wherever you are today, it is bitterly cold and it will remain so right the way through the day. Let's take a look.
GMTV weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals.
Oh,
cold rain for the whole family every morning.
So for today, we can see where the snow is going to fall. We could see some patchy snow across much of England and Wales, but it's anywhere from northeast England up towards eastern Scotland. That's where the snow showers are now piling in, and they will continue to do so, becoming frequent and heavier through the day. And then this area of snow, where rain and snow moving its way northwards, will merge with the showers here, and that means more snow tonight for the northeast. And even across towards Northern Ireland, you could get one or two snow flurries this afternoon, but I think that's where the best of the weather is likely to be. So this morning then, well, wherever you are, it's freezing cold. The wind is very strong, and that means the lowest wind chill today probably around minus 10, minus 11 degrees Celsius. That's wind chill. Typical temperatures probably around 0 to 3 as we head through the afternoon. So we can see where the snow showers are. They've been moving in across central and eastern areas of Scotland overnight, down towards Northumberland, as well as Yorkshire, and even places such as Lincolnshire are seeing one or two. Down towards the south, currently we're seeing a little bit of patchy rain. As that rain moves up, though, across the morning, you can see it's going to turn colder, and that rain will turn to snow. So we could see 1 or 2 centimetres across England and Wales as we head through the afternoon. So wherever you are this morning, wrap up warm, because it is going to be bitterly cold. Through the afternoon then, for the northwest of the country of Scotland, that's where you'll see the sunshine. But those snow showers really pushing in. Temperatures struggling there, as you can see. The wind is so strong, they could actually push across to the southwest of Scotland, as well as places such as Carlisle, but places such as Manchester probably getting away with some dry weather. Cloudy conditions moving up across the Midlands as well as East Anglia by around 3 o'clock, anywhere from Essex across to Oxfordshire and South Wales, seeing that snow. Rain currently and continue to be down towards the West Country. Much of Wales then getting away with a dry afternoon, but as I said, 1 or 2 snow showers likely just to clip the eastern and northern side of Northern Ireland, and temperatures here will be the highest, 4 Celsius at the very best. Tonight then, as I said, the snow in the south will merge with the showers in the north. That means more snow, particularly for the central and eastern area of Scotland, as well as northeast England. Fog in the south, freezing cold in the west, with temperatures down to -3. And that's how we see tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to be very, very tricky indeed across eastern Scotland, because by then we could see up to 8 inches of snow elsewhere. It's dying out. More rain to come later on in the day. Here's your summary. Check out what the weather will be like this weekend on our website, gm.tv.
Good morning. The time is 6:27 on Thursday, the 3rd of January, 2008.
Yes, you're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. In the next half hour, there's still chaos on parts of the railway system. We'll be asking how commuters get compensation.
And we'll head to Nairobi, where a huge demonstration banned by the government is expected to take place today.
And we'll find out why the sisters have all opted for double mastectomies to rule out a hereditary risk of breast cancer. But our top story this morning, drivers are being advised to prepare for hazardous conditions with snow and freezing temperatures forecast for much of the country. The Highways Agency is preparing a fleet of gritters to treat motorways and A-roads. Matt Arnold is at a gritting depot in Leicester. What's the picture, Matt?
Good morning to you, John. Well, a very chilly morning here at Leicester Forest, the service station, which is where this gritting depot is, just alongside the M1. And as you can see by the gritter in front of me, the snow plough is out and attached. You won't get a better indication that snow is forecast. The Met Office is saying that in the extreme north of England and Scotland, there's a 60% chance of snow. We've just got these pictures in from Durham with the first flakes settling up there now. For the rest of the country, well, it's pretty much an east-west divide. If you took the spine of England as being the M1, everybody on the east side of that, Met Office is saying a 40% chance of snow there, and that goes right the way down to London and the southeast. On the west side of the country, a slightly reduced chance, perhaps 20% chance of snow there. Now, the gritters are all out here. I saw them go very early this morning. In this area alone, they're covering Leicestershire, Warwickshire and Staffordshire. 24 gritters out on the road. Well, let's take a sample look at the rest of the national picture. Over in Lincolnshire, 43 gridders are out there, and they've got the benefit of 10 roadside weather stations to keep them fully in the loop and the information up to date. In Barnsley in South Yorkshire, 12 gridders are out. They have 5 roadside sensors there to keep their information spot on too. Down in Cornwall in the beautiful southwest, they stockpile 10,000 tons of salt to deal with the 875 miles of A and B roads they have down there. And of course, it's those A and B roads, when the snow does come and we get a cold snap, that get the worst of the conditions. So good that they're keeping those ones clear. And I found out this morning that there's 11 and a quarter tons of salt on board one of these machines behind me. That's 9 cubic meters, a massive amount. And if you do get stuck behind one on a 3-lane motorway, and let's face it, the chances this morning are very high that you will, probably best to get past it, because there's enough salt on board to keep them going for 50 miles, John.
Matt, thanks very much indeed.
Now let's get this morning's other news. Good morning, Priya.
Thanks, Gloria. Thanks. Good morning. In Kenya, the opposition leader has insisted a banned march will go ahead today, despite concerns it could lead to further violence. 1 million protesters are expected to rally in the capital, Nairobi. Hundreds of people have died in the troubles following the re-election of President Kibaki last week. The Foreign Office has warned against all non-essential travel to the country. Back here, in the rail regulator says it's launching an urgent investigation into the engineering delays on the West Coast Main Line, which threatened to disrupt commuter travel again this morning. Network Rail has admitted a shortage of staff is to blame for the problems and may now be fined. Well, Jackie Cabler is at Birmingham International Station for us this morning. Hello, Jackie.
Good morning, Priya. Yes, Virgin Trains still advising its passengers not to travel today. They've described the whole thing as a fiasco. Their trains have been very badly affected. And this is all due, of course, to these problems on the West Coast Main Line. Engineering works, which have now overrun for the 4th successive day, basically closing a large section of line between Coventry, Northampton and Milton Keynes. And that's had enormous knock-on effects. Passengers yesterday describing nightmare journeys extended by 2 or 3 hours. In some places, having to get on buses, trains not running in many parts of the country, and it's going to be a similar scene today. Network Rail are blaming the fact that they don't have enough specialist staff, and we don't seem to be able to get a date out of them when this is all going to be sorted. The rail regulator is launching an investigation, and Network Rail could face a hefty fine over this, as well as for having Liverpool Street Station in London closed yesterday, again due to overrunning engineering works. Meanwhile, this is going to be raised as a matter of urgency in Parliament on Monday when they all return from their Christmas break. The Labour MP Louise Ellman says she wants an explanation and an apology to the thousands of passengers affected. Network Rail are refusing to comment at the moment on reports that it could be next Monday before things are sorted, Priya.
Jackie, thank you. The missing data scandal may be much worse than the government's admitted, according to a group of MPs. A report by the Commons Justice Committee warns the massive security breach at Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs wasn't an isolated case, and it's now calling for government departments to be held criminally responsible for data protection breaches. Christmas overspending will lead to record levels of debt this year. Accountants predict that around 120,000 people will be declared insolvent this year after splashing out over the festive season. Figures show that many shoppers were tempted by discounts online and on the high street. Opera singer Russell Watson has begun an intensive course of radiotherapy in a bid to combat a recurring brain tumour. The singer's been told his eyesight could be damaged as a result of the treatment. Tiffany Royce reports.
Not the way he may have wished to start the new year, but as Russell Watson headed to hospital to begin a grueling course of radiotherapy, the singer was characteristically upbeat.
I just see it as another challenge and hopefully a step in the right direction and a step to getting this thing sorted out once and for all.
Father of two, Russell had surgery to remove the brain tumour in October, his second operation in less than a year. He first discovered he was ill in 2006, but made a full recovery. Sadly, scans soon revealed the tumour had grown back. Now he will undergo intensive radiotherapy.
It's 5 weeks solid, 5 days a week. It's pretty intense. I think as a human being, if you're going through anything like this, you've got to have something to aim for, and you've got to believe that you're going to be all right.
A tough start to the year for a man who must be hoping 2008 really will bring him the all clear. I said that's
life. Let's hope so. Look at what's on our website this morning. Discover the top 10 overseas property hotspots for 2008. Are you happy with your body shape? Take part in our New Year Lifestyle Survey. And we reveal what you're most likely to leave in a hotel room. All that and more on the website, gm.tv. It's just about 6:34. Here's what's happening where you are.
Thanks, Priya. Good morning. The main stories here in the Northwest. Former Manchester City star Joey Barton is back in court later this morning, charged with assault and affray. The Newcastle and England footballer will appear before Liverpool magistrates via video link from Walton Jail, having spent Christmas and New Year in custody. He's been charged in connection with an incident outside a McDonald's in Liverpool city centre. A murder investigation's underway after a man was stabbed to death in South Manchester. Police were called to St Brendan's Road in Withington around 9:30 last night, where they found the victim with knife wounds. He was taken to hospital but was pronounced dead on arrival. It's another day of delays and disruption on the West Coast Main Line, with no direct trains between the North West and London for a fourth successive day. The work at Rugby should have finished before New Year's Eve, but has overrun. It's left Network Rail, who are responsible for the upkeep of the track, facing a hefty fine. Commuters will have to continue to use buses for part of the route or travel via Sheffield. The 30th anniversary of the world's first test tube baby, who was born at a hospital in Oldham, is being marked this week. Louise Brown was delivered at Oldham General in 1978. She's since given birth to her own son in 2006. And one of the scientists who made it possible has opened a new IVF laboratory at St Mary's Hospital in Manchester.
Doctors, scientists, nurses, we've all worked together as a team. And here now, I can see the facilities you've offered to keep this practice going with plenty of staff and also the right conditions where they all can work together.
Bolton Wanderers striker El Hadj Diouf is launching his own charity to help disadvantaged children. The Diouf Foundation will work with youngsters here in the UK and in Senegal, where the player was born. The striker says he wants to repay some of the help he received in Africa as a youngster. In last night's football, Manchester City moved into the Premier League top four with a 2-0 win at Newcastle United. They replaced Liverpool, who could only manage a 1-1 draw at home to Wigan. Bolton beat Derby 1-0, while Blackburn overcame Sunderland by the same score. That's it for now. I'm back at 7:05. In a moment, we'll return to Gloria and John, but first, a look at the region's weather. And don't forget, if you have any pictures of snow or frost this morning, then please send them to us.
Pantene Pro-V Winter Rescue. Forecasting a great hair day, whatever the weather. Sponsors of GMTV Weather.
Most places will start with a dry morning with thin cloud and a few bright swells. This afternoon, staying dry, highs of just 2 degrees, 36 Fahrenheit.
Welcome back to News Hour. 23 minutes to 7 is the time. Quick look at the morning papers. The Times concentrates on the rise in oil prices, which we featured a few moments ago. The Independent, the future starts here. That's a reflection of the caucuses in Iowa, which we're featuring also on the programme. Murder of the children who sought sanctuary in the church. Well, you heard about that on the News Hour yesterday morning. Absolutely appalling atrocity in Kenya. A mass rally planned there today. £140 rise in council taxes forecast by the Daily Express. The weather forecaster, Sean, is going to get married, according to them as well. Daily Mirror, what a waste. That's a terrible, awful story of a man who went out to look for his dog and was murdered by youngsters, allegedly, who'd been drinking vodka. Front page of the Daily Mail, a researcher of Gordon Brown, one of Gordon Brown's researchers, saying that parents should get tax breaks to help them bring up their children. And the front page of the Sun, that's Joey Barton, the Newcastle United footballer, who is being held on in custody at the moment, apparently crying himself to sleep in the cells in Liverpool every night.
And many of the papers detailing the chaos on the railways following the overrunning engineering works. This is inside the Daily Telegraph. The misery continues for rail travellers, and it certainly does. And joining me now is Ashwin Kumar from the National Rail Watchdog, Passenger Focus. Thank you for getting up. You've had a busy time at the moment.
I have indeed.
What's your advice to people who still need to make that journey?
Well, I'm in fact going to Manchester myself straight after the programme, and the thing that I would say is do check the websites and possibly phone up, because the situation is changing every day, and that's what's wrong about this. We should be able to plan our journeys, not have to wake up in the morning and phone up to find out what we're doing that day.
It's been chaotic, it's been a nightmare for passengers. Can we get compensation?
Well, yes, and the thing to do is to get in touch with your rail company, get a claim form, make the claim. Because what's going to happen is that Network Rail will have to pay compensation to the rail company, and we as passengers aren't going to see any of that unless we actually make the claim.
But you accept that obviously engineering works have to take place. That's how we get a better service in the long run. So what's the best way to do it while minimising disruption?
Well, I mean, the point is that when these works have happened, in a year's time, we're going to get better service between London and the North West. It's going to be faster, more frequent trains. So the work has got to happen, but the process of change has got to be managed properly. We've got Network Rail has to get a grip of its project management, because we're going to have this work going on for the rest of this year at weekends. And we can't have this happening every time there's more engineering works.
And when you've been speaking to passengers, what's the mood, really?
Well, people are angry. I mean, they're frustrated. You know, we've done research, Passenger Focus has done research, to find out what passengers want when there's disruption. And the top thing they all say is to be able to plan. Now, the deal is in the rail industry that Network Rail should give 12 weeks' notice of any engineering works so that when you buy your ticket, you know what service you're getting. And that's what's not happened here.
So, basically, people should look into that compensation, though.
Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
The thing that they can do in the immediate.
Yes.
OK, that's thanks to you for explaining that, and thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Kenya's opposition party is to go ahead with a mass march in Nairobi this morning, despite a police ban on the event. Hundreds of people have now died in the violence which broke out following the disputed re-election of President Kibaki last week. Sue Jamieson is in Nairobi for us this morning. Just arrived there. Sue, good to see you. Just give us your first impressions.
Well, John, it's a very tense situation indeed. You've got up to a million supporters of the opposition leader, Raila Odinga, who are massing about 2 or 3 kilometres in that direction. In fact, we've been seeing smoke rising from over there, although it seems to have disappeared at the moment. They are trying to march into a park. Now, what I've seen, even just coming in from the airport, hundreds and hundreds of armed police and these GSUs, general service units, all armed, lining that route. But what we also have at Kibera, which is the stronghold of Odinga, where these people are trying to come in from, we have many more there. Now, they have already used a water cannon this morning, and they've been using tear gas to try and hold these people back away from the centre, because obviously they fear that if they're able to get into Nairobi, then the potential for violence is even more, and they have seen enough of that over the last few days. So I would say it's extremely tense. I think most people here are going to be trying to stay indoors and certainly lock up businesses, because it is potentially a powder keg. We're going to have a press conference happening in about an hour or two from the opposition, who are going to try and explain how their rally is going to take place, and we're not exactly sure when it's going to take place. I suspect it's going to be opportunist when it happens.
Sue, we're having a bit of trouble with the wind that's blowing through your hair and also through your microphone. I think if you move your right shoulder towards a camera, we might ease that situation a little bit. That's it, more like it. Is there any sign of the two sides actually getting together at all?
Well, I'm also having trouble with whatever it is from your end, so I'll just press on. At the moment, there is no sign of the two sides really getting together, and I think I can illustrate that best by showing you this morning's papers. Now, both of them, Save Our Beloved Country, Save Our Beloved Country. This is almost as though it's the media saying to the two leaders, you've got to talk. I mean, I'll just give you an idea of some of the other things here. No grievance and no cause is worth the innocent blood of Kenyan children. And they speak about their leaders issuing half-hearted calls for peace from the comfort of their hotels and their bulletproof limousines. I think there's a real fear here from many Kenyans that their country is standing on the brink. They've had 40 years of peace. The economy has grown, and they see all that perhaps being thrown away in a matter of days, particularly when you have both sides. You have Raila Odinga, the opposition leader, saying, I won't rest until I have the right democratic result. And then you have the President Kibaki, who's saying, well, there's no need for a recount because I won fair and square. And from the outside as well, no real sign of mediation. There was supposed to be the Ghanaian president coming here to start talking, but he's not here yet. So I'd say it's a very difficult situation. Today has been described to me as make or break day.
It sure is, I'm sure. Sue, thanks very much indeed for battling against the odds. You take care. On the line now, British teacher Alison Rogers, who ran a school in Kisumu in Kenya, which has been burned down during those riots. Alison, thanks very much indeed for getting up to talk to us. You had a terrifying ordeal. Just describe the circumstances in which you were forced to leave your property.
Basically, let me just put you right on one thing. The school itself, I was a head teacher of, I think that's still okay. We had reports that it had burnt down. We couldn't go and see it because it was unsafe, but I think the school is okay where I was working. However, with the children's charity and the business that we owned and invested everything in, you know, sold our house in London 2 years ago and invested everything in on the shores of Lake Victoria, only 8 kilometres outside Kisumu, that one has been absolutely burnt to the ground. It's been looted. Every tree that was there, and we planted over 100 trees, I mean, beautiful ones, mahogany from all over Kenya, we'd collected and planted things. That one has been burnt to the ground. There is nothing left there at all. And the people that were there were chased off. They were going to be killed or threatened with being killed. And that included one woman and three of her children and her niece. One of them was aged 4, another aged 5, another one aged 12, and her niece was aged 18, hoping to go to college or university. Now, they were chased by about 200 people barefoot along the shores of the lake. Until they eventually managed to hiding, and through the kindness of some other local people, managed to get to our house in Kisumu Centre itself. We couldn't even go to see the business property because it was unsafe and the roads were on fire and people were looting and killing Kikuyus in the street. And as you're aware, I'm married to a Kikuyu and my children are Kikuyu, so we were in hiding in the house at the time.
Well, it must have been a terrifying ordeal for you. And what about the children, and indeed a little baby, a very tiny baby you have? I mean, how have you all coped through this?
Well, of course, we felt extremely vulnerable, and as a mother, as I suppose any mother there can guess, you know, your first priority is your children and trying to keep them safe, and if you feel that you're not in a position to keep them safe, that is the most terrifying thing that you can be faced with. The baby, of course, is 3 weeks old, very, very tiny. I had her by emergency cesarean section, so I wasn't particularly well. I wasn't able to drive, even if I could. And my husband couldn't go out, so I was the one that had to go and look for food or try and find things because, you know, I was the only one who politically doesn't have a statement to make. So that was very difficult. And I think it's been very difficult on my 7-year-old and my 9-year-old. I've had to give a lot of attention to the baby, feeding every 4 hours. Thank goodness I'm breastfeeding and not on formula milk because I couldn't have got it. And, you know, they've got lots of unanswered questions and lots of frustrations and lots of anxieties themselves that they don't understand and that we haven't been able to properly sit down and talk to them about. My little girl, when people came to our gate to try and break into the house and try and get us and the other two Kikuyu families that we were hiding, she said, "Mom, I'm so frightened. I can't even, you know, I feel too sick to be able to pack." Wow. My little boy has just been very, very, very quiet. I'm trying to be strong.
So, Alison, I'm not the least surprised. Regrettably, I have to end it there. I do know that having been in a hotel, you know, I think in the safe hands or safer hands of some friends in Nairobi, we wish you well and hope that you and your lovely family stay safe. Thank you very much, Dee, for talking to us.
Now, after watching their mother and their sister die of breast cancer, three sisters have had their breasts removed as a preventative measure. We'll be speaking to them in just a moment, but first, here's Anna Thomas on how their lives have been affected by the disease.
Mandy, Christine and Susan have lived with the spectre of cancer since their teens. They watched their mother, Kathleen, fight breast cancer for 4 years, until her death in 1980. She was just 46. 2 years later, their father, Frank, died from lung cancer. Then in 1994, tragedy struck again. Their sister, Angela, was diagnosed with breast cancer at just 32. 2 years later, she died. In October 2003, Christine was told she too had breast cancer. She had a double mastectomy followed by intensive radiotherapy and chemotherapy. It was then that Mandy and Susan took the drastic decision to have total mastectomies without ever being diagnosed with cancer. And now, sisters with a unique bond, they're all looking forward to a fearless future.
And I'm joined by those amazing women now, Mandy McSwiggan, Christine Creasy and Susan Chaffin. Good morning to you all. Christine,
yes.
You're the only one of the three people here who have had breast cancer.
Mm-hmm.
How are you?
I'm in remission again, thanks goodness to treatment and wonderful doctors.
And Mandy, you've had a mastectomy as a preventative measure.
I have, yes.
Tell me about the decision.
It was an easy decision, obviously, after watching Mum and Angie, and then obviously with Christine getting the disease. We were given this great opportunity. I found the decision very easy. It was the right one for me.
Susan?
Yeah, exactly the same, actually. Watching how people, when they have breast cancer, suffer with the treatment, even though obviously it was a radical decision to make, compared to people that suffer with it, it really was quite an easy ride for Mandy and I.
What did you think when you found out, when they told you that this is what they were going to do? Did you...
I thought it was a good idea because I did have the chance to have this done 7 years ago when our sister died, and I just said I didn't take the option. So, and once they got the option back up again and I got the disease, they decided to have their breast done without any big decision, really.
And what about your husband? What did... Yes,
actually, he didn't want to influence me either way. Although when we did discuss it, I think he was erring towards me having it done. And having two young children, I thought it was the right thing to do, really, just to get over the operations and just look forward to the future with a bit more peace of mind, really.
It's a terrible disease with a huge genetic predisposition. I mean, what help? What would you say to women who are watching this, who are suffering? What's helped you?
I just think I've been so lucky with friends, family, and the doctors and the treatments have come on so much in the last since Angie had it 10 years ago. I wouldn't have been alive if I'd had it 10 years ago because of the treatment that has come on now. The chemotherapy is fantastic.
And your prognosis is good.
I hope so. I hope so.
Yeah. And how do you two feel? It must have been incredible. I mean, it's a very big surgery that you underwent, isn't it? It must have been very painful. How long were you in hospital?
It wasn't actually as painful as what we first thought. First couple of days, it was more sort of a discomfort than a pain. But literally 2 days and we were out within four, so...
But when you went into that operating theatre, what was going through your head?
Are we doing the right thing? Are we doing the right thing? What are we going to look like? Obviously, because it does have a cosmetic.
Even at that stage, you're asking that question. Yeah. It's not surprising now.
I'm not criticising
you at all for that.
Yeah, definitely. But still, in the back of your mind, you know you're doing it for the right reasons, because you certainly didn't want to go through or face what our sisters and mother had gone through. So, and any opportunity, it was the right thing.
Well, you are three very inspirational women, and it's a pleasure to talk to you this morning. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in. And you can get all the essential facts and information about breast cancer, including a symptoms checker, on our website, gm.tv.
Yeah, that's just about it from the two of us. We're handing over to Kate and Ben for GMTV Today.
And after the break, Claire with the latest on the wintry weather blasting parts of Britain this morning.
It's Christmas, with all that rushing around and a little overindulgence left you feeling sluggish and sometimes bloated. Me too. Perfect time for a change. I'm starting the year with the Activiate New You plan, full of healthy diet and lifestyle choices, plus Activia every day.
Activia helps improve slower digestive transit.
So join me for the Activia New You plan. Happy New Year. Happy New You.
Activia.
This is the sale at Harvey's, and this leather sofa's an incredible $299. Save up to half price, plus an extra 10% off absolutely everything. And get up to 3 years, no deposit, free credit. This stylish table and six chairs, now $699. Everything's reduced in the up to half price sale, plus an extra 10% off. Like this wardrobe, now $299. Offers extended, end Monday, 8 p.m. Harvey's, bringing your home to life.
When you get a cold or flu, you try to keep going, but deep down you still feel ill. Olbus Powerflu is a new two-tablet cold and flu treatment. Nothing treats more cold and flu symptoms than the powerful multi-relief tablet, plus a high-dose chewable vitamin C tablet to support your immune system deep down. Ask your pharmacist for new Olbus Powerflu. Powerful, deep down relief.
Understand family holidays. That's why we're first choice.
Here, take a look at this. A 32-inch Hitachi digital LCD TV for only $399.99.
How do you make a smoothie innocent? Well, Blue Sky and Sunshine always helps. Then, hand-pick 10 strawberries. Add half a banana, sustainably sourced by Carlos from the Rainforest Alliance, 19 pressed grapes, and a squeeze of orange and lemon juice. Cram it into a recycled plastic bottle. Phew, it fits. Innocent smoothies. Innocent by nature.
Still waiting for Cupid and Fate? Find love for yourself at Match.com.
Nice, thanks.
Quit smoking, and this is what you're up against. Smoking increases the number of receptors in your brain that thrive on nicotine. Take their supply away, they go mad. They won't let you break the habit without a fight. Nicotine reduces cravings because it contains therapeutic nicotine, so you can wean the beasts off gradually and give your willpower a fighting chance to do the rest. Tame the beast and quit with nicotine.
Drench your lips with Blistex Lip Splash. Rollable hydration for super smooth, moisturised lips. Blistex, beautiful feeling.
It's time for Great Escapes with GMTV. Prepare to be whisked away to five amazing destinations with your celebrity tour guides. So take in the sights and sample the delights of hotspots from around the world, starting with Cuba. Great Escapes, new for 2008 on GMTV.
GMTV weather, sponsored by Nestlé Cereals. Whole grain for the whole family every morning.
Hello there. Most of us will be seeing some snow today. Certainly everybody will be feeling the bitterly cold wind. Temperatures typically at the moment between around -1 and 1, and it's feeling more like -10. So wherever you are today, wrap up warm. As you can see from our snow map, over the next 12 hours or so, expecting up to 10 centimetres in places across central and eastern areas of Scotland, down towards northeast England. And even further south, there's going to be, I'd say, up to 2 centimetres in places as rain moves its way northwards. So wherever you are, remember it could be tricky on the road. The radar shows this very nicely indeed. If I just step out the way, you can see here a rash of showers moving in. They're rain showers up towards the North Sea, but as they hit the cold air inland, you can see here right the way down the coast there and also inland. In fact, we have a TV crew for you this morning in Durham, where it has been snowing for the last, I'd say, hour or so. And as you can see, it's quite heavy in places, causing problems with visibility. So wherever you are today, remember, you could see some of this, if not now, but maybe later, particularly, I'd say, anywhere from the Wash northwards where it is likely to be heavy. So that's the picture at the moment. What's happening elsewhere? Well, to the west, as you can see, we're seeing drier skies this morning, and eventually you will see some sunshine here. In fact, sunshine across western areas of Scotland, perhaps even northwest England, particularly for this morning rather than this afternoon. Currently, there's cloud and rain moving across the far south of England, and that's going to hit the cold air, and it is going to turn to snow. So it's not particularly pleasant out there this morning. It's probably the coldest day we've seen for a long, long time with that wind chill factor. And the snow showers become more frequent through the afternoon and also heavier, so expect accumulations, particularly over the higher ground away from the coastline. And as you can see, the wind so strong, it's going to be pushing those showers right inland down towards the southwest of Scotland. The east, the west coast seeing some dry weather, but in the east you can see the cloud spilling ahead of the main weather system, and this is where we're likely to see the snow continuing through the morning into the afternoon, anywhere from, I'd say, Essex to the south coast of Wales through the afternoon. But to the north of that, you can see it's mostly dry. One or two snow flurries likely also for Northern Ireland, but here you should see some sunshine, and that's where the highest temperature will be. The snow continues in the east and the north tonight, fog in the south, and then tomorrow it will slowly die out. Here's your summary. For your local weekend weather, visit our website, gm.tv.
Good morning. Britain wakes up to the first serious cold snap of the winter. Snow is falling across large parts of the country, with more on the way.
With temperatures falling below freezing, the gritters are already in action. But will we cope? Let's not be cynical. Britain may not grind to a halt as usual. We'll be finding out a bit later on.
You say that, but if the trains are anything to go by, the signs are not looking good. Major disruptions could continue into next week, I'm afraid. That's what we're talking about today, and it's Thursday, the 3rd of January 2008.
Good morning, you're watching GMTV Today. It is approaching 7 o'clock. We've got more on all of those stories from Priya in just a moment.
Yes, it's not a whiteout everywhere yet, but it is bitterly cold out there. The very latest on the snow throughout the morning. I'm really hoping it's not going to snow in London this morning because I'm working and I don't want Darcy to see snow for the first time when I'm not here.
And you've got to be together when that
happens. I've got to be together.
It's very
special. It'll be like white Christmas.
It'll happen at some point, though. If the weather doesn't hamper your journey, well, the rail repairs just might. We've been on the West Coast line to see just how long the trip is taking, the rail and bus journey from hell for you in 40 minutes' time.
Yeah, and they are building up an impressive fan base. Van Tramp, they're a British rock band, launching an assault on the charts, and they're performing live for us just after 7:30.
I have to say, Kate was looking very perky this morning
very
when
perky.
I wandered past her in the corridor
nice
talking
boys.
To the band.
Nice boys.
She hasn't
nice
looked that
boys.
Perky since McFlyery.
Oh dear, don't make me seem sad. Here's Priya.
Thanks, Kate. The top story at 7 o'clock. Drivers are being advised to prepare for hazardous conditions this morning with snow and freezing temperatures forecast for much of the country. The Highways Agency is preparing a fleet of gritters to treat motorways and A-roads. Well, Matt Arnold is at a gritting depot in Leicestershire. Good morning, Matt.
Good morning to you, Priya, from Leicester Forest East alongside the M1, which is running smoothly, incidentally, just alongside me here. But as you can see, no better indication that snow is forecast than the fact that the snow ploughs are out on the gritters here. So what is the likelihood of snow in the country? Well, if you're in Scotland or the extreme north of England, the Met Office is saying there's a 60% chance of snow. These pictures recently in from Durham showing the extent of the snow already up there. For the rest of the country, though, well, there's pretty much an east-west divide right down there. If you like the M1, the spine of Britain. So anyone on the east side of that, the Met Office are saying a 40% chance of snow, and that's all the way down to London and the southeast. If you're on the west side of that, a reduced chance, about 20%. Now, the Highways Agency tell me that they have available 500 gritters nationally across the country. They've all got 11.25 tons of salt on board. That's 9 cubic metres. One word of advice, if you do get stuck behind one on a motorway this morning, and the likelihood is that you will see them out and about, probably overtake safely because there's enough salt on board to do a three-lane motorway for 50 miles, Priya.
It's a lot of salt, Matt, thank you. In Kenya, the opposition leader has insisted a banned protest march will go ahead today, despite pleas for the post-election violence to stop. The Foreign Office has warned against all non-essential travel to the country. Sue Jameson has just sent this report from the capital, Nairobi.
This has been described to me as make or break day. There are up to 1 million supporters of the opposition leader Raila Odinga who are massing about 2 or 3 kilometres in that direction. They're hoping to come into the city to a park where they're going to hold a protest rally. Now, I've seen this morning hundreds of armed police and these GSUs, general service units, waiting for them all down the main road, but also back there in the Kibera area, which is one of the strongholds of Odinga. Again, you have mass forces there. Already they have used a water cannon on protesters today to try and keep them away. Tear gas has been used as well. And just to give you an idea of perhaps some of the desperation that ordinary Kenyans are feeling with the potential clashes, both the newspapers this morning have this headline, Save Our Beloved Country. And they're urging both the president and also the opposition leader to come together to start talking so that this doesn't descend into total chaos. Meanwhile, for the 7,000 British people living here, the Foreign Office has updated its advice, saying to stay away from any of these rallies, to stay indoors and no non-essential travel. Back to you.
Thank you, Sue. The rail regulator says it's launching an urgent investigation into the engineering delays on the West Coast mainline, which threatened to disrupt commuter travel again this morning. Network Rail has admitted a shortage of staff is to blame for the problems and may now be fined. Well, Jackie Kabler is at Birmingham International Station for us this morning. Hi, Jackie.
Good morning. Yes, Virgin Trains have described this as an absolute fiasco. They're advising their passengers not to travel again.
Unfortunately, we're having some sound problems with Jackie. We'll bring you her in the next bulletin. The race for the White House begins today in the American state of Iowa. Voters there will decide which candidates from the Republican and Democratic parties they want to run for US president. The Democrats, with either Hillary Clinton at the helm or Senator Barack Obama, are expected to win the election, which takes place in November this year. And we'll be live to Iowa for the latest on the race for the White House in around 3 minutes. The missing data scandal may be much worse than the government's admitted, according to a group of MPs. A report by the Commons Justice Committee warns that the massive security breach at Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs wasn't an isolated case, and it's calling for government departments to be held criminally responsible for data protection breaches. Christmas overspending will lead to record levels of debt this year. Accountants predict that around 120,000 people will be declared insolvent this year after splashing out over the festive season. Figures show that many shoppers were tempted by discounts online and on the high street. The record price of oil, now trading at $100 a barrel, means that UK motorists are facing the highest ever prices at the pump. Filling a typical 50-litre tank now costs £7.36 more than a year ago. That's according to the AA.